So basically, in this chapter, we have discussed and we have been discussing about the bonding, yeah, that occurs between atoms, and the types of bonding also based on the also the cause of why such bonding occurs, yeah, which is related to the electron's orbital, the electron location within the shells of the atom. And what we haven't discussed in details maybe is are the properties inferred from the bonding. So, okay, we have discussed on the Bohrian model of atom, yeah, which in which each atom consists of different shell, yeah, and 1, 2, 3, and then the n is the first principal quantum number. Yeah, the nucleus contains number of protons, which is basically also will indicate the number of the atom, the Z. And the protons plus the neutrons, yeah, will make up most of the atomic mass of the atom. So usually the mass of the electrons is very small that they are not counted as the mass of atom. So the mass of the atom mostly is composed from the mass of the nucleus, which consists of the protons and neutrons. In the electrons' energy states, we have discussed this, that each have energy stage, yeah, in which the more the electrons located to the outside from the of the atom, then the more of energy it has, yeah, because then the electrons need to spin with higher energy in order that it stays in the correct orbits. Okay? And we have discussed here the first first quantum number, the n, which indicates the shell. Then we have discussed also the subshell or the second quantum number, which is p, yeah, k, yeah, which can be either s, p, d, or f. In within that each of the subshell, it consists of orbitals. And we have also discussed how the order that each of these subshells and orbitals are filled by electron. So this is an example of stable electron configuration. An atom is stable when it has complete s and p subshells. And usually they tend to be non-reactive or unreactive. And we have discussed also in the previous session, those atoms in the rightmost column, yeah, the helium, the neon, argon, and krypton, their outermost subshells are usually filled completely by electrons. In the helium, it has its atomic number is 2. It has 2 protons. It has also 2 electrons, yeah, 1s2. The first shell is completely filled. Neon, the 2 cells are completely filled, yeah. The outermost cells is completely filled. The 2s2 and 2p6. And argon has the 2 subshells of the third shell completely filled, yeah, 3s2 and 3p6. Krypton has the 2 subshells of the fourth shell, yeah, 4s and 4p, also completely filled, 4s2 and 4p6. If we survey the elements, yeah, in the periodic table, most elements, however, do not have stable configuration of electron. Okay, helium is stable because all the subshells are completely filled, but hydrogen has an atomic number of 1. It has 1 proton, 1 electron, only one of its first shell, first subshell is filled, first electron only. So it needs one more electron in order that it becomes stable like helium. Then we have also lithium, beryllium, yeah, in the first column, yeah, where it has an extra 1 electron in its outermost shell, okay, 2s1 or 2s2. Then boron and carbon also here, more extra electron, and they need to be filled. Then we have also here in the third row, sodium, magnesium, and allium, where it has also electrons already in the third shell. So they are not stable because the outermost shell is usually not filled completely. Yeah, here is how it is located. In the previous slide, maybe you don't see the atomic letter. Now we see it. So the first column, as I mentioned, they are very electropositive because they have this one extra electron in the outermost shell. That's why they tend to give up this one electron, release this one electron to become a positive ion. Yeah, this why electropositive electron. The rightmost electron after the inert gases here, yeah, they need one more electron to be filled, to be completely filled in the outermost shell or outermost subshell. So when they accept one electron, they become negative ion. That's why they are called electronegative element. Yeah, the column, also the next column on its left also needs two more electrons in order to be completely filled. That's why they readily acquire electrons to become ion, to become negative ions. So this property is called as the electronegativity. The more right in the periodic table, the more the atoms is, the more the atoms are electronegative. So they have larger electronegativity. The more left to the periodic table, the more they have the less they have electronegativity, the smaller their electronegativity. So here, for example, in this table, the electronegativity number is mentioned here. Yeah, hydrogen has 2.1 electronegativity, lithium 1, sodium 0.9, potassium 0.8, etc. While the rightmost one, of course, not the inert gases. The inert gases, they don't have electronegativity because their shells and their subshells are completely filled. The group 7A here, the seven column, has very large electronegativity. Yeah? Fluorine has 4, chlorine has 3, bromine has 2.8, iodine is 2.5, astatine is 2.2. So they really tend to capture one electron in order to be filled, in order to be completely filled in their outermost shell. Then the next one has a little bit smaller electronegativity compared to this one. Oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, and then polonium. Okay. So ionic bonding will occur between positive ions and negative ions. That's why electrons are being transferred from the electropositive atom, yeah, which release electrons so that it becomes cation, positive ion, captured by the electronegative atom, for example here chlorine, to become anion. Then each of the atom is stable, but since their charges are not neutral anymore, they tend then to attract each other, yeah, to be attracted by the Coulombic attraction. That's why in ionic bonding, large difference in the electronegativity is required. So this example shows the ionic bonding that occurs in some of the compound, sodium chloride. As you see here, the salt, the salt, kitchen salt, happens between they have different electronegativity, large differences in the electronegativity. Sodium has very small electronegativity, 0.9, while chlorine has very large electronegativity, 3.0. Magnesium oxide also is relatively ionic because the magnesium has quite small, 1.2 electronegativity. Oxygen has large electronegativity, 3.5. Calcium fluoride has also ionic bonding. Calcium has 1.0 electronegativity. Fluorine has 4.0 electronegativity. Cesium chloride, similarly, 0.5 versus 3. So whenever the atoms, the two types of elements have a large difference in their electronegativity, then you can expect that they will have ionic bonding. So usually this occurs in many ceramics. So the left part of the atoms will release an electrons or give up electrons, while the right part of the atoms here will acquire electrons. So covalent bonding, on the other hand, occurs usually when the electronegativity between the elements within that molecule, between the atoms in that molecule, do not differ a lot. Yeah. So that's why the electron is not given up or captured, but instead they are being shared together. So for example, here, methane, yeah, CH4, electrons are being shared by the carbon and the surrounding four hydrogen atoms, so that they are complete. Carbon has four valence electron, it needs four more. Hydrogen has one valence electron, it needs one more to be completed. And but their electronegativities are comparable, they do not differ a lot. Let's see here. Carbon is here in the four, yeah. Hydrogen is here. Hydrogen is 2.1, carbon has 2.5 electronegativity. So the numbers, the electronegativity numbers are not that different, only 0.4 difference. So that is why instead of making ionic bonding, they tend to make covalent bonding by sharing the electrons. Okay, they share electrons, share the same orbital. So here are the example of covalent bonding. Water is also example of covalent bonding. Hydrogen is 2.1 with oxygen 2.0, right? Electronegativities of the two metals, sorry, the two elements, they do not differ a lot. That's why they make covalent bonding. Carbon, yeah, diamond, between bonding between carbon and carbon, of course, the electronegativities are the same, then they tend to make covalent bonding. Silicon carbide, they are of the same column, yeah, 1.8 versus 2.5, almost similar, not that different, the electronegativities between these two elements. That's why they also make covalent bonding. Between gallium and arsenide, electronegativity is different, is only 1.6 versus 2.0. Okay. So covalent bonding can occur in molecules with non-metals or in molecules having metals and non-metals. And elemental solids, usually elemental solids, and or compound solids, about column 4A. This is column 4A. Yeah, surrounding column 4A. So metallic bonding from sea of donated valence electrons. So not only single electron, but multiple electrons make electron cloud. That electron can travel between one atom to another like this. Yeah, the negative electron cloud, they make this metallic bonding. This is the primary bond for metal element and their alloys. Alloys are compound of metals, metal elements. So this figure shows the metallic bonds form when atom give up their valence electron here. This is the valence electrons, which forms electron sea or electron cloud. There's some people say electron cloud or electron sea. The positively charged atom cores are bonded by mutual attraction to the negatively charged electrons. So when voltage is applied to a metal, then the electron here, yeah, you apply voltage, for example, by putting batteries, yeah, then the electron can easily move towards the positive terminal, yeah, going back again and then coming out from the negative terminal. So when electron move, there current occurs, the electronic current occurs. So that is why, yes, that is why metallic metals are usually good electronic conductor. Okay, when voltage is applied to an ionic material, yeah, ionic bonding, yeah, ionic bonding material, let's say for example salt, entire ions must move to cause a current flow. A entire ion must move to cause a current to flow. It's why ion movement in this case is slow and the electrical conductivity is poor. If you look at sodium chloride, it is a poor conductor, yeah, because the whole ion needs to move, and the whole ion means the whole atom, which is heavy. While in the case of metal, they have the electron clouds. The electron is very small, very, very light. It can move easily and faster rather than positive or negative ions. Secondary bonding we have also discussed in the previous session, so in the form of dipole bonding due to the asymmetric electron clouds, yeah, temporary different distribution of electrons. It's also secondary bonding due to hydrogen, which we call the hydrogen bonding. Permanent dipoles modules can be induced, yeah, like this, and then cause secondary bonding also. Liquid chloric acid, yeah, has also secondary bonding between the relatively negatively charged chlorine with the surrounding positively charged with hydrogen from the other chloric acid molecule. Secondary bonding also occurs between change of polymers, yeah, later as we learn about polymer in the next chapter, in the other chapters. Okay, so while we have studied ionic and covalent to metallic, sometimes for ionic bonding, there is no 100% ionic bonding. Sometimes some compound has ionic but also has covalent bonding at the same time. So that's why we can calculate that in terms of percent ionicity. Yeah, so this is determined by the difference of the electronegativity between the elements in that compound. Yeah, so the percent of ionic conductivity here equals to 1 minus exponent of minus xA minus xB square over 4. So you see, if the difference between xA and xB is very large, it means one is very electropositive, the other one is very electronegative, yeah, it means this number will be very large. Negative of this number will be, exponent of negative this number will be very small. Okay, so this will approach to zero. But then that's why when xA is very much different than xB, we have that percent ionicity very high, close to one. Okay, this happens in ionic ceramics. But when in, for example, diamond, where it has covalent bonding, the XA and XB is almost the same. Yeah, XA and XB almost the same. So the difference here is very small. The exponent of this is not that large. The exponent of this is of negative of a small number means still very large. One minus a large number relatively. Very small number, so the percent ionicity will be smaller. So that's why covalent bonding has smaller ionicity. It doesn't mean that it does not have ionic bonding at all. It may have metallic bonding on the other hand, alloys of metal that have metallic bonding on the other hand, yeah, XA is completely equal to XB. Yeah, so this becomes zero. Yeah, exponent of zero is one. One minus one equals to zero. That's why metals, yeah, alkali metals or alloy has percent ionicity close to zero. Yeah. So a summary for bonding, yeah, this has been presented in the previous slide. Yeah, the secondary has the smallest bonding energy, while the ionic bonding has very large energy. So the bonding curve arises from attractive plus repulsive interaction between atoms or ions. Okay, so when the atoms and ions are separated in very large distance, you see here that the energy is still considerably large. When it gets closer, the energy gets very minimum. When energy minimum means they are very stable. Okay, so this is the optimum distance where the attractive energy, the potential energy between the two atoms or ions are at its smallest or at its minimum. Okay, so it means the most stable configuration. But when you try to push the atom further closer towards the other atom, the energy starts to increase again, and finally there will be repulsive force like this. above certain distance, below smaller than certain distance here, the energy become repulsive and then they tend to repel each other. Okay, so this depends on the atomic number and also the radius of that number. And the energy, EA here is the attractive force, ER is the repulsive force, and the total energy equals to EA plus ER. Okay, here A is Coulombic, caused by the attractive, yeah, caused by the charge, by the charge difference. So A equals to Z1, the atomic number of the first atom, times the electron number, and then multiply to Z2 times E divided by 4 by epsilon 0. Epsilon 0 is the dielectricity, the permittivity of the space between the two atoms. For sodium chloride, for example, which is very ionic, yeah, Z1 will be the sodium, which is plus 1, Z2, ZCl, oh sorry, this is a valence, the valence number of electron. Z2 is chlorine, which has minus 1, because it tends to attract electron. Okay, so this will become the attractive energy. Then B is, I'm not sure, B is the another constant. So here, the force F is the differential of energy over distance. Okay, force U is minus dE over dR for R0 equals to, so from this here, derived from here, equals to minus dEA dR at R0. R0 is here at the balance distance, equal minus dER dR. The force should be zero at equilibrium, which is at R0. Yeah, minus sign in this force means that by definition, the repulsive force will be a plus force. Yeah. So how would then the properties be changed based on this bonding energy between the atoms? Yeah. So the, for example, melting temperature of metal is determined by this bonding energy. The bonding length and the bond energy is zero. Yeah, this is the R0 is the balance, the equilibrium, where the atoms are in equilibrium, but when they are at unstretched length, so the bond energy increases, so they become non-equilibrium. So at melting temperature, metal with larger melting temperature tends to have smaller bonding energy. Smaller bonding energy means more stable. Yeah, more stable bonding. Smaller means more negative. Yeah, more negative means that from energy point of view, they are more stable. Yeah. So because they are more stable, it takes higher temperature to make them melt, to make the metal melt. On the other hand, metal which has smaller melting temperature usually has smaller TM in terms of negativity, so it means actually larger value of bonding energy. The value of bonding energy means that they are not stable. They are easily can be excited by external energy so that they will melt. So TM here is larger, the melting point is larger if E0 is larger towards the negative direction here. So it means actually smaller and more stable. Yeah. So elastic modulus, which you will learn also later in the mechanical properties of material. Okay, so this is elastic modulus is defined E as the ratio between stress and strain. Yeah, between stress and strain. Stress, this is stress. Stress is the force exerted to a certain cross section area. So this cross section area will be the A0, and ratio between stress and strain. So sigma over strain equals to Young's modulus. The strain here is the delta L, the strain here is the delta L, the extension over the initial length. The length extension over the initial length, or the deformation compared to the undeformed length. So it means that material with higher Young's modulus, or it means it requires more force in order that it will stretch the same length. Okay, material with higher Young's modulus, we call it as more rigid compared to material with low Young's modulus or elastic modulus. For example, like steel or iron has of course higher Young's modulus compared to rubber. Rubber has very small Young's modulus, that's why it is with rubber, even with small force, you can easily stretch rubber. Okay, but with steel or iron, it requires you to exert a lot of force, a lot of stress in order that that steel or that iron is stretched. Yeah. Well, how does that happen with Young's modulus is larger if this E0, which is the energy at the equilibrium position between the atoms, it has a larger value in the negative energy. Yeah. So this is like positive, right? This is negative. It means actually smaller equilibrium energy. Yeah, when it is smaller, or it means the absolute value is larger, then the Young's modulus becomes larger, because here in this region it is more stable compared to this material, the blue one. Yeah, if it is more stable, then you need to exert more energy to break the energy, to break the binding or the bonding, the bond between the atoms in that material. Yeah. Another property that is also influenced by the bonding energy is the thermal expansion coefficient of thermal expansion, alpha. Yeah, usually it is defined as, this is basically a strain. Yeah, how much strain occurs when the material is being heated, is heated to elevated temperature. Yeah, this is the alpha. So alpha larger means that it takes more heat, more temperature difference in order that the material will elongate, or will extend, or will be stretched more. So alpha is larger, of course, when the E0 is smaller. E0 is smaller here. Alpha is larger when E0 is smaller. Alpha is larger means that it is easily expandable. Even with small, let's say, for example, this one, delta T just 1 degree Celsius. If alpha is larger, then you have more strain. If delta T is, alpha is smaller, then the epsilon is smaller. When alpha is larger, it means with same temperature, you can have more increased length. This is due to a larger alpha, this one, the blue one, larger alpha here means because the energy binding is smaller. Binding energy is smaller in terms of negative energy. So it is not stable. The binding between the atom is not that stable. So with small heat, you can easily break that binding, so they become elongated. The material become elongated or extending. When the E0 is larger, E0 larger means that, or smaller in the negative, in negative direction, yeah, larger in the negative, the E0, it means then the material is more stable. So it takes more heat in order to extend the same length. It means that the alpha is smaller. So summary, the property in ceramics between ionic and covalent bonding, ceramics has very high bonding energy due to its ionic and covalent bonding, usually then ceramic has high or melting temperature. Yeah, like bricks. You know, bricks is a type of ceramics, right? Usually, it doesn't melt easily, even if you put it in thousands of degrees Celsius of temperature, it doesn't melt easily. And it is very difficult to extend a brick or ceramic material. It doesn't also expand when it is heated easily, okay? Metals, on the other hand, metallic bonding is not that large bonding energy. The melting temperature is moderate. So with 1,000 degree, 1,500 degree, you can melt iron, for example. The E, Young's modulus, is also moderate. You can still extend compared to ceramics. Yeah, ceramics, the Young's modulus is in the hundreds of gigapascal, while metals is in the range maybe around hundreds of megapascal. Polymers is the weakest because the binding is covalent and plus secondary. And the crystalline structure is usually more of one-dimensional or two-dimensional, and then after that, they have secondary bonding. That's why the melting temperature is also very small. You can easily melt PET, your plastic bottle, right? Maybe several hundred degrees Celsius, it already melts. You can easily bend. You can easily extend or stretch your plastic bottle or plastic glass. And also, when you heat it up a little bit, it expand easily also. The alpha is very large. So this is how the different material property is influenced by the different bonding that that material has. Then, so here is the binding energy for the four binding mechanism. Ionic has the largest, followed by covalent bonding. Then metallic has 20 to 5 to 200. Van der Waals has less than 10. Yeah, this is the weakest, like occurs in the polymer material. Atoms or ions are separated by an equilibrium spacing that corresponds to the minimum interatomic energy of a pair or of atoms or ions, or when zero force is acting to repel or attract the atoms or ions. So this is the, as we mentioned earlier, the binding energy, yeah, when it is at the equilibrium spacing. This is the interatomic spacing 2R. So here the force at this equilibrium energy, at the minimum energy, is the force is exactly zero. So where it does not attract and it does not repel each other. When you make the two core of atoms closer to each other at the distance, energy increases again, then it starts to have repulsion force. Yeah, to have repulsion force. When they are a bit farther from each other, from this equilibrium distance, they start to have attraction force. So this is how coefficient of thermal expansion R of alpha or DLDT, linear thermal strain, delta L over L0 equals to alpha times the thermal temperature difference. Yeah, alpha asymmetry at the equilibrium position. Okay, and the volume thermal strain is when delta V over the initial volume, like this. So at this position, no expansion is possible because it is the most stable position. Atoms just vibrate back and forth from this, like this back and forth. They do not really expand. Smaller EM. With larger energy, so the thermal expansion coefficient is smaller. It means it takes higher temperature difference in order to expand that material. Okay, so that will be all for the